This is a course about the workings and the transformative possibilities of contemporary market economies. And it is also a course about the ideas that we need to understand the operation of contemporary economies and to explore what they can become. Thus, the forefront theme of the course is not the study of economics, as one might achieve in an economics course, but the understanding of the economy itself. An understanding not to be restricted by the established methods in contemporary economics. The background theme of the course is the task of identifying and developing the ideas that we require for such an understanding. So, therefore, the power and limits of the established economics and the alternative futures of economics. My purpose today is to give you an initial view of the agenda of the course. There are no formal requirements for this course. It is not necessary to have advanced study of economics. Because, as we shall see, the ideas that are pertinent to this inquiry do not come solely from what is now known as economics. What is mainly required from you is a disposition to consider these problems free from the restraints of the disciplinary divisions in the established university culture. The assignments and readings for the course are posted on the course website. There are certain books assigned. The course is not about the readings. Many courses are about readings, but not this one and not any course that I teach. My understanding of what a course should be is that the threshold requirement for a course is that it not be replaceable by a book. It should be a struggle to think, a demonstration of the possibilities of living thought at the frontier. The purpose of the readings is to supply equipment with which to engage the argument of the course. A secondary purpose of the readings is to give us here in this room, with very different backgrounds, some common denominator, some shared element that will facilitate our discussions. The course is an argument that I shall attempt to develop as forcefully as possible. And what I want from you is that you use your engagement with this argument, your discussion of it, your resistance to it, your suggestion of alternative lines of thinking as an opportunity to develop your own voice and your own position with respect to these problems. I will speak in every class, but I'm hoping for the greatest possible amount of engagement from you in class discussion. For undergraduates who may be enrolled in the course, we are organizing a section. The teaching assistant is here, Mohammed Hamdi, and probably next week, in the second week of the course, we will organize a section for undergraduates. The only general written requirement in the course is a paper that I will ask you to write toward the end of the semester, and I will assign it several weeks before the end of term. And it will be designed capaciously to facilitate your engagement with the argument of the course. I will ask you to criticize some central theme in the argument of the course and to use your criticism as an opportunity to develop your position. So it will not be a research paper. It will be an opportunity for reflection, for intellectual action on your part. And I will encourage, rather than dissuade, collaboration, consultation among you. You will be free to consult anyone you like about your ideas and to elicit, if you like, comments on your draft from others, whether in the course or not. And the only restraint on this collaboration will be the normal restraint in writing, that at the end of the day you'll be able to say in good faith that the final text is largely the expression of your own mind. All the classes will be videotaped, and the videotape will be placed a day or two after each class on the course website. So there's no need to take copious notes unless you find that note-taking assists the clarification of your own ideas. Undergraduates will also be asked in the course of the semester to write two brief response papers of something like 5 pages each, which again will not be research exercises. They will be opportunities to develop and demonstrate engagement with the argument of the course as we go along. Any questions about the basic nature of the course or about the requirements before I attempt to present an initial view of the agenda? No questions. So I should also say that I'm happy to discuss after class. I teach Mondays through Thursdays, 1 to 3 at this time, the same time of this class. And I'm generally available in my office after 3 throughout the week. So you can come and speak to me without making a previous appointment at those times, generally any day you like. It is a fantastic subject matter that stands at the very center of the practical concerns of humanity and of national politics throughout the world. And the remarkable fact is that the ideas that are available to us with which to address this subject matter are astonishingly limited. There's a huge mismatch, an imbalance, a disproportion between the weight of the problems and the development of the ideas. So that's the situation. It's not of my invention. It's the circumstance that we encounter. And I understand this effort as very much against the current, against the spirit of the age, against the circumstance, as an attempt to deal with this imbalance. and to formulate ideas that we need to enlarge our sense of the possible. Insight into the actual is always related to the imagination of the possible. If our imagination of transformative opportunity is very restricted, it means that our insight into the actual is also very limited. To understand a phenomenon in any branch of thought, including natural science, is to grasp what it can become under certain circumstances or interventions. So if our imagination of transformative opportunity is limited, it means that we have very limited insight into the existent. And what we take to be our insight is in fact, for the most part, only a retrospective rationalization of what exists. So here we deal with this general problem of thought in the area of the most pressing problems of humanity, the problems of material life that are constantly reenacted in the theater of national politics all over the world. With the help of, as I said, a very restricted repertory of ideas. So I said at the beginning in my initial statement that this course has two themes. The foreground theme is the study of the economy and of what it can become, the market economy especially, and its transformative possibilities. And the background theme is the theme of the ideas that we need. So first, the foreground theme. Here is the perspective from which I propose to engage these problems. Let me describe it first in terms that relate to the ideological debate in the world, as well as to the theoretical controversy in political economy. You know that in the ideological contests around the world, the main model is the government versus the market. More government, less market. Less market, more government. Or some compromise between state and market. A premise of this traditional form of ideological debate is that the market has, to a very large extent, a natural and necessary form. A market is a market, property is property, and contract is contract. There is a range of variation studied, for example, in the conventional academic literature about varieties of capitalism, but the range of variation is very limited. Now, I dispute this premise. And the rejection of this premise is one of the starting points of the argument that I propose to develop. My view, which is in part the outcome of 150 years of the evolution of legal thought, is that the market has no natural and necessary form. And that the form that is now established or triumphant, especially in the rich North Atlantic world, represents a subset of a much larger universe of institutional possibilities. And moreover, on this alternative view, that the advancement of our most pressing concerns about economic growth, for example, or about inequality, depend on the institutional reconstruction of the economy, on the exploration of these alternative possible forms of the market, and cannot be adequately addressed simply by regulating the market economy as it now exists, or by counterbalancing the inequalities generated in the market economy through retrospective redistribution by tax and transfer, that is to say, by progressive taxation and social spending. We can address these problems according to this view that animates my perspective only by exploring alternative institutional arrangements of the market economy itself. Now, in another course, I gave a historical example of what this idea means. And now, in this different context, I propose to appeal to the same example. Because we are in the United States, from early American history. So in the first half of the 19th century, aside from the great contest over African slavery, which was so decisive for American history, there were at least two other contests that were equally important for the development of the country. Contest over agriculture and the contest over finance. A very general view in the early 19th century in Britain and in much of Europe, a view shared by conservative ideologies and later by Marxists, is that agrarian concentration was inevitable. An inevitable characteristic of what Marx came to call capitalism. The countryside would be emptied out, large entrepreneurial estates in agriculture would be formed, and only large-scale property would be feasible in agriculture. Now, the Americans rejected this view, which was shared by conservatives and socialists in Europe. They distributed the lands in the agrarian frontier under the Homestead Acts. And they organized a partnership between government, the national government and local governments, and family farmers, that in today's vocabulary we would describe as a decentralized strategic coordination. The government didn't only supply land. It helped build the whole commercial and technological infrastructure of family-scale agriculture. And even, for example, the academic institutions, the so-called land-grant colleges, which were a part of the American agrarian evolution. And later, a whole system of food stockpiles, of price supports, of forms of insurance against the combination of climate volatility and price volatility that always besets agriculture. And moreover, the Americans began to shape in the relations among the family farmers a series of practices that we today, in our vocabulary, would call cooperative competition. That is to say, the family farmers remained individual proprietors competing against one another, But at the same time, they pooled resources, technological, commercial, and financial. For example, they shared tractors later, or they helped one another at harvest, achieving through this cooperation economies of scale. And through these initiatives, they created the most efficient system of agriculture that had ever existed in the world, even though its premise was the rejection of the imperative of agrarian concentration. A similar event happened in finance. There was a contest over financial concentration in the United States. It culminated in the presidency of Andrew Jackson, in the dissolution of the National Bank. And for over 100 years, any bank that was not just a state bank was prohibited in the United States. They developed the most decentralized system of credit at the service of the local producer that had ever existed in the world. These were absolutely decisive initiatives in the history of the United States. But what were they? They were not the regulation of the market economy, and they were not the attempt to correct inequalities of the market economy after the fact through compensatory redistribution by progressive taxation and redistributive social spending. They were innovations in the institutional form of the market economy, influencing the primary distribution of economic advantage and opportunity rather than the after-the-fact correction of that primary distribution. And those are therefore real historical examples of what I mean by innovation in the institutional form of the market economy. So that's the perspective from which I propose to engage the problem of understanding the contemporary market economies and their problems. The perspective is that the present form of the market economy represents only a subset, a segment, of its possible forms, and that the resolution of our basic problems, such as our problems about growth or about inequality, requires further instances of institutional innovation. Like these early 19th century American examples, not with the same content, but as it were with the same method, but in spades, in every department of economic life. That's the perspective. Now, further, I propose to use this perspective to focus on two themes that I regard as having extraordinary theoretical and practical significance. So the first theme is the theme of the nature and fate of the most advanced practice of production that exists in each historical circumstance. Now, this interest that I'm describing in the most advanced practice of production and in its dissemination is not a novelty of mine. This was also the theme selected by the two greatest thinkers in the history of economics, both of them philosophers, Adam Smith and Karl Marx. Each of them fixed on what he regarded as the most advanced practice of production in his time. In the context of what he believed to be an emerging economic regime or system. For Adam Smith, it was mechanized manufacturing, as in his pin factory. In the context of the regime that he called commercial society. And for Adam Smith, it was for Karl Marx, it was industrial mass production in its earliest stages in the context of the regime that he described as capitalism. And the idea of these economists and philosophers was that by understanding the nature and fate and limits and dissemination of this most advanced practice of production, they could discover the deepest truths about economic life and about its transformative possibilities. The vanguard would reveal the secrets. And I intend to copy this example in my argument by now addressing what I take to be the vanguard today. So, the vanguard today is sometimes described as the knowledge economy, or even more generically, the new economy. And we often associate it with the high technology sector, that's Silicon Valley. So at the surface, it's characterized by accumulation of knowledge, technology, and capital. And by technologies that shorten the distance between conception and execution, like robotics or 3D printers, and permit the destandardization of products and services. But at a deeper level, this advanced practice of production is characterized by a set of methods or practices that are not uniquely dependent on any particular set of technological instruments. So one set of practices is the attenuation of the contrast between supervisory jobs and jobs of execution. The plan of production is continuously revised in the process of being implemented. And that goes together with a relativization of the distinction among specialized roles in the workplace, in the technical division of labor. So no longer the fixed niche as in Adam Smith's pin factory or Henry Ford's assembly line. Then another methodological characteristic of this advanced form of production is that it does not starkly oppose cooperation and competition. It promotes a combination of cooperation and competition. For example, the regions in which this advanced practice of production flourish, the advanced industrial regions, as in California or around Boston, or in southwestern Germany, or in north central Italy, or in Catalonia, seem to be characterized by networks of small and medium-sized advanced firms that, while they compete against one another, also participate in a circulation of people, resources, practices, and ideas, and to some extent cooperate in the construction of a shared industrial culture. The advanced form of production is the form that is closest to the imagination. And as it advances, it seems to require a higher level of discretion and of trust among its participants. Now we have the following problem, a fateful problem for economic growth and for politics in the contemporary societies. Before, in the period of the so-called Industrial Revolution, the then advanced sector, mechanized manufacturing, served as a model which was rapidly disseminated throughout the whole economy. Every part of the economy was transformed on the model of mechanized manufacturing, ultimately even agriculture. Now it seems that in principle, the new advanced sector, this emerging knowledge economy, should be susceptible to even more rapid and universal dissemination because its practices are not intrinsically related to any particular sector of production. Nevertheless, we find that what happens in the world is the opposite. The vanguard practice, rather than being universally disseminated, remains largely confined within relatively isolated vanguards. So in all the major economies of the world, there is now such an advanced sector. In China or India or Brazil, just as much as in the United States, Germany, and Japan. And these advanced sectors throughout the world form a kind of network, sharing ideas and practices and people with one another. But within their national economies, relatively isolated from the other sectors. And this new form of division between the advanced and the backward sectors, between the vanguards and the rearguards, has become in the world an enormous source of inequality and exclusion and a tremendous constraint on economic growth. So the question arises, why is this happening? Why is this vanguardism being confined? And under what conditions could it be universally disseminated? Under what changes in the institutional arrangements and in culture or in politics could the vanguardism be generalized? So that's the first substantive theme that I propose to address in this agenda that I'm trying to give you a preview of. The second substantive theme is the theme of crisis. So economic growth is periodically interrupted by crisis, and especially financial crisis. How are we to understand the ultimate sources of the cyclical or discontinuous character of economic growth? It seems that there are two major sources. The first basic source is that the breakthrough of constraints on supply and the breakthroughs of constraints on demand don't automatically reinforce or create each other. Or to state the same idea in a different form, supply does not automatically create its own demand. That was the premise, or one of the premises of Keynes's economics. But the inverse is also true. Demand does not automatically create its own supply. Let me give you an analogy that can help to understand the nature of this problem. So now in the discourse of the business schools and of the management consultants, a central conception or slogan is the idea of disruptive innovation. What does the disruptive entrepreneur do according to this conception? He brings together a set of technologies and a business model to create new demand and new markets. So he acts simultaneously on the supply side and on the demand side. He doesn't simply create products and services for existing markets and existing demand, for customers who are already there. He creates new demand and new markets. He operates on both sides. But this at the micro level. Now, what is the macro equivalent to this micro conception of disruptive innovation? That's a way of presenting the problem that I'm calling the problem of the first source of economic instability or discontinuity. The second source has to do with the troubled relation of finance to the real economy. So in principle, according to official doctrine, the point of finance should be to fund the productive agenda of society. The capital assembled in finance represents an excess over current consumption, and it should therefore finance the creation of the future. But there is the following enigma. According to the empirical research, well over 80% of the funding of productive activity is generated within the production system itself, largely through the retained and reinvested earnings of private firms. Now then you can ask a very simple and disconcerting question. What is the point of all of that money in the banks and the stock markets? What is its relation to the real economy? If it is true that the production system is largely self-financed, internally financed, it seems that the preponderance of financial activity has only a oblique or episodic relation to real economic activity. So, example of the episodic relation is initial public offerings. Initial public offerings on the stock market are a way of mobilizing capital to finance production. But they're tiny as a proportion of financial activity. So is venture capital, for example. Minuscule within the totality of financial trading activity. Then there's the oblique relation of finance to the real economy, which is, you can say, that the trading establishes a benchmark of value, which then makes it possible for the firms to offer collateral as a basis for borrowing money from financial institutions. But for the most part, they don't borrow money. They finance themselves internally. So what's the point of all of that money? So there's this vast money, now dramatically so in the present, in the contemporary circumstance, large corporations sitting on huge amounts of liquidity. With only the most indirect or enigmatic relation to finance. So finance, then it seems, becomes rather than a good servant, a bad master. And the transactions of the real economy, rather than being its real object, become, as it were, its pretext for the trading activity that has only this very uncertain relation to the agenda of production. So on the official view, if there is a problem in finance, in the capital markets, it must be that there is some localized defect of competition, of economic power, or of information in the capital markets, or else some localized defect in the regulatory response to the localized market defect. But what is not admitted in this view is that alternative institutional arrangements could decisively shape or reshape the relation of finance to the real economy and make finance more or less useful to the productive agenda of society, enlisted in the service of production rather than allowing it to serve itself. So these are the two themes that I propose to take as the focus in the substantive agenda: the fate of the advanced practice of production and the nature of crisis, of the cyclical or discontinuous character of economic growth. And each of these two themes, then, requires us to address the question of the institutional constraints or the institutional alternatives for the organization of the market economy. Now, I've said quite a lot already, and before going further in the presentation of this agenda, let me stop and ask whether you have comments or questions. Yes?
When you were discussing disruptive entrepreneurs,
yes,
were you speaking on the scale of like Larry Page and Google, or a different kind of shift? I was a little confused.
Well, it's not necessarily big, very big businesses. It can be at many different scales. But I was really just alluding, not to an idea of mine, but to a very fashionable idea, an idea that already exercises great influence in the practical business culture. So right now in the United States, there, in the business schools, there is no slogan more fashionable than disruptive innovation. And that's what disruptive innovation means. Disruptive innovation means not simply innovation in the creation of new products and services on the supply side, but also innovation in the creation of new customers, markets, and demands, that is, the demand side. So what I'm saying is that the established ideas already present the problem of relating breakthroughs on the supply side and breakthroughs on the demand side at the micro level, but not at the macro level. So that was sort of the next thing that I was going to say about how this, the discussion of these two large themes, relates to the practical discourse of politics and of economic debate in these societies. So it relates to the two most important practical themes, growth and inequality. So take the United States now. It is only a slight exaggeration to say that the United States, for a long time, has had no strategy of economic growth. There is no strategy of economic growth in the United States other than a strategy composed of two elements. The first element is the policy of easy money conducted by the central bank, the Federal Reserve, not by the central government of the United States, but by the central bank. And the second element is the support for demand. Demand stimulus. And of course, these two elements are very closely related by the use of a counter-cyclical management of the economy through fiscal and monetary policy. Insofar as the United States has a strategy of economic growth, those are practically the only two elements of that strategy. And there is a universe of debate about the economy within economics, but especially within national politics, in which the situation could be described in simplified terms along the following lines. The progressives, the left-leaning politicians and economists, focus on demand. And the right wing focuses on supply. But their vision of supply, their supply-side economics, has a reified, a very restricted view of what the market economy can be. So what is notably absent from this debate in the United States, but also in much of the world, is any progressive approach to the supply side. That's what's missing. And it seems that that's what would be required for a powerful view of economic growth to be formed in this historical circumstance. Now take the other salient issue in the contemporary debates, inequality. So one issue is growth, the other issue is inequality. The dominant view shared on all sides of the spectrum of economic and political debate is that the way to address inequality is to correct the inequalities generated in the market economy after the fact through retrospective redistribution by tax and transfer. Meaning, first by progressive taxation on the revenue-raising side of the budget, and second by redistributive social entitlements on the spending side of the budget. So the primary distribution of income is taken as given, and then it is to be corrected after the fact through this retrospective redistribution, this secondary redistribution through tax and transfer. Now, what I want to take as an axis for debate about the problem of inequality is the contrast between two views. One view which accepts this single-minded focus on compensatory and retrospective redistribution, and the other view which insists on the innovations that by generating a sustained broadening of economic and educational opportunity could influence the primary distribution of economic advantage. And that seems to be much more powerful in its potential effect. And that project is in turn related to what I called a moment ago the progressive approach to the supply side. So that's why this notion that the market economy can have alternative institutional forms is not simply a theoretical speculation, but has immense potential practical significance. Because it touches in a dramatic and direct way on these two central problems of practical politics and economic life. Growth and inequality. Those are the two most fundamental problems. Those are the problems at the center of national debate all over the world. And we need some perspective from which to address them. So what I'm proposing then in this definition, in this provisional definition of my agenda, is that we take the discussion of the fate of the vanguard sector and the discussion of the nature and sources of crisis in the economy, discontinuity and slump, as a way, as an occasion, as a provocation to form ideas that can allow us to deepen our understanding of the problems of growth and of inequality. So the intellectual agenda relates to the immediate concerns of the contemporary debate at one level. Now, would someone like to comment on that? Is that connection clear? We're not entering into the details of that debate. I'm simply trying to map the terrain in this initial presentation. Yes.
I have a question about the essence of the past.
Yes.
In the last 2 centuries, we had the greatest economic growth in the history and also
inequality.
So why should we be so concerned about expanding our universe of possible ways of production and not from just kind of fixing the current system?
Well, fixing the current system, that's the issue. What does it mean to fix it? Well, I don't know what radical means in this context. So I gave you an example of two threats to economic growth. One threat is we have an emergent vanguard form of production, the new economy, the knowledge economy, but it remains very confined. So that's simultaneously a threat to growth and a threat to the limitations on inequality. So only a very small part of the labor force participates in these vanguards. The rest is excluded, even in the richest and most egalitarian countries in the world. And then we have two traditional devices by which to attenuate inequality. One device is compensatory redistribution by tax and transfer. And the other device is political support for small business against big business. And it seems that these two devices are not sufficient to serve as adequate antidotes to the tremendous force of inequality and exclusion that results from this division between contrasts and vanguards. Now, why are we interested in that? For these two reasons, that this situation limits growth, and therefore our ability to lift the majority of humanity out of poverty, infirmity, and drudgery. And second, that it limits our success in overcoming the extremes of inequality. So we haven't said anything so far about how radical or not these innovations should be. I'm simply describing the problem, which doesn't seem to be adequately addressed by the existing ideas. So In the world today, if you had to choose one political slogan that exercises the most universal appeal, I would say that slogan is the idea of socially inclusive economic growth. All over the world. We want economic growth, but we want the economic growth to have a broad social basis, to include many people. Well, now we're translating that notion into more particular problems, including this problem of the dissemination of the advanced sector. So that's how we might become interested in this. And I, for the moment, I'm trying to formulate these problems in a way which is relatively neutral with respect to the familiar spectrum of political or ideological debate. So in the familiar spectrum of political or ideological debate, the leftist is the one who wants more state, and the conservative or the rightist is the one who wants more market. But I'm not discussing that. I'm discussing what kind of market. And so that is that perspective is in a way perpendicular. It traverses this traditional spectrum. And it engages our established concerns with growth and with inequality. That's how I'm trying to define the agenda. Yes?
If we're already considering institutional forms and different institutional forms, how come we're limiting ourselves, or we're starting with the idea that it must be a market economy, just a different form of market economy? Because one can, in theory, conceive of a non-market economy, or one that's primarily based around production.
I don't understand. What do you mean, based around production?
So
because what I take a market economy to mean is a broad decentralization of sources of economic initiative. Many economic agents able to bargain on their own initiatives and for their own account. But that doesn't mean that it has to look like the economic regimes that we now call capitalism. So there's a large confusion in the history of social and economic thought about this. So let's take the example of two thinkers at opposite poles of the conventional ideological spectrum, Karl Marx and Friedrich Hayek. So Marx believed that there was a unique recurrent system, one of a series of types of social and economic organization that recurs in history, which he called capitalism. So there's a limited list of economic regimes, slavery, feudalism, capitalism, socialism. Each of them is an indivisible system. Each of them has its unique laws, and their foreordained succession in history is governed by laws of historical change. So then the examples of decentralized economies that exist in the world are subsumed under that typology. It's a system. Now, I'm starting from a different premise, and I hope to argue for it in the course of our discussions, that there is no such system. That there is a contingent regime, that its elements reinforce each other, but that it is in no sense an indivisible package, and that the forms of the market economy that were generated in history up to now represent just a segment of a much broader universe of institutional possibilities. So nothing is being excluded by the idea of a market economy other than the extreme notion of some radical centralization of command and decision. And we think that the most fundamental attraction of the idea of decentralization is that no one knows enough. So in this sense, economic decentralization is simply the arrangement of experimentalism. Now take the other thinker, Friedrich Hayek. So Hayek believed that if we have a system of free coordination among economic agents, without a state, in some mythical island, any such system will spontaneously generate basically the same regime of private rights. There is, as it were, a natural regime of coordination among free and equal economic agents. And according to this view, the ultimate object of economic theory is to define the elements of this system of coordination among free and equal economic agents. Now, I take that view to be also mistaken, just like Marx's view, because what the jurists discovered in 150 years of legal thought is that the market economy has no natural and necessary form, that property and contract can be organized in very different ways, and that the choice among these alternative ways influences the organization of production and exchange, as well as the distribution of economic advantage. But of course, this is a claim I'm making, and I'm not proposing now to demonstrate it. I'm simply signaling this other position alongside these positions. I'm trying to complicate the picture, so that in our argument, we already begin to move within a larger intellectual terrain. Yes?
Yes. Very intrigued by the way you position the issue of inequality and how a different combination or a different reorganization of production forces.
Yes.
So looking forward to further discussions. What's been kind of troubling me lately is looking at inequality from the power law perspective, right? From the distribution 80 and 20, 20 and 80, right? From Pareto, right? And so I think lately we've been seeing that a lot of phenomena, like non-social phenomena, like either earthquakes or there is this thing called positive attachment, distribution of nodes in websites, right, which also follow similar pattern as inequality. So I'm getting this question whether inequality is unavoidable systemic phenomenon, that interactions of agents, be it people or websites, almost unavoidable lead to this unequal distribution, confirmed by this powerful distribution.
So let me try and phrase the problem in the context of the history of political and economic ideas. So the 19th century liberals and socialists, for the most part, believed that there was a pre-established harmony, a natural and necessary convergence between the conditions of economic progress, the material empowerment of humanity, and the conditions for our liberation from entrenched schemes of rigid social division and hierarchy, extreme class inequality. John Stuart Mill and Karl Marx both believe that. And that there was a single institutional trajectory, a system of rights, that could simultaneously create the conditions for our material advance and for our moral emancipation from extreme inequality. Now, I take it as a fact that we today are no longer able to believe that. That we are no longer able to believe that there is a single system of rights or of institutional arrangements that embodies the pre-established harmony, the inevitable convergence between our material and moral interests. And we are then at risk of believing the opposite, namely that there is a tragic and insoluble contradiction between our moral and material interests. But that belief seems to be also dogmatic and false. So an alternative would be to suppose that there is some zone of possible intersection between the institutional conditions of our material advance and of our moral advance. Some set of institutional arrangements that enables us both to become more richer and more powerful and to diminish the extremes of domination and dependence in society. And that seems to be a reasonable hope. And here's a very simple intuitive reason why one might think that that hope is reasonable. One might say that the fundamental economic tragedy of these societies, of these contemporary societies in which we live, is that in them, a vast amount of human intensity and talent is squandered for lack of opportunity and of equipment. So people are capable of tremendous intensity, of energy, but it's like it evaporates because they can't do anything with it. And if they could do more with it, we would all be richer and more powerful, and we would be less unequal. That's what we want. But we want that without being able to share in the beliefs of these 19th century liberals and socialists that there is some single dogmatic legal and institutional blueprint that can definitively embody the convergence of our material and moral interests. So that's the terrain. That's what I take to be the terrain in which we're working, in which we hope to identify the area of affinity between our material and moral interests. Now, these two greatest economists in the history of thought, Adam Smith and Karl Marx, these two philosophers, are two examples of prophets who believed in this possible connection between our material empowerment and our moral emancipation. We just can't follow their dogmatic and necessitarian assumptions, so we need to reconstitute their project on different terms. So I see this inquiry, this discussion, as being an expression of that larger ambition. Now, that leads me then to say this, that I said this agenda that I described about focused on the twin problems of the fate of the vanguard and the nature of crisis has implications for right now, for the dominant contemporary debates about growth and about inequality. But I also want to relate it to themes that are not present in the contemporary debate. On the contrary, are completely suppressed, and that regard the future of humanity. And now let me give an example to you of these themes. So my intention is not simply to organize an intervention in the contemporary debate, in the terms of the contemporary debate. My intention is also to address subjects that are completely banished from the contemporary debate, but that are fundamental. So, as an example, I choose the status of labor, one of the great subjects of political economy. So you know, Karl Marx, for example, believed that a defining characteristic of the regime that he called capitalism is that labor is bought and sold. The predominance of wage labor. The labor power of human beings becomes a commodity, like a thing. And he believed that to be a decisive characteristic of capitalism. Now, in the 19th century, a universal belief among liberals and socialists was that wage labor represented a transient and defective form of free labor and was tainted by the features of slavery and serfdom. So it wasn't just Marx and the socialists who believed this. All the great liberal thinkers believed this. And not just the theoreticians, but the practical politicians. For example, reread Abraham Lincoln's address to the Missouri Agricultural Society. He says, no free man would accept to be a wage laborer other than out of extreme necessity or folly. So the generalized belief in the 19th century was that wage labor could only be accepted as a transitional and exceptional form of free labor, and had to give way to the two higher forms of free labor, self-employment and cooperation. Now, it was much easier for them to believe this. Let me give you an astonishing fact. When Tocqueville visited the United States in 1830, only one white man in five worked for another white man. So there was African slavery, but among the population of the free whites, the vast majority were self-employed, either acting alone or in cooperation. And the universal belief was that those were the superior forms of free labor. Economically dependent wage labor was slavery. It was only in the 20th century, that is very recently in historical time, that the predominance of wage labor as the form of free labor was naturalized, when up to then it had always been rejected. Now then we can ask today, under what circumstances could we reinvent or reform this 19th century belief in not only the superiority, but the practicality of the combination of self-employment with cooperation over wage labor, over economically dependent wage labor, the buying and selling of labor time, which makes people into things. So a standard objection to the feasibility of self-employment and of cooperation as the mainstays of economic organization is that they would be incompatible with economies of scale required in a dynamic, large, contemporary economy. But whether they are or not compatible with economies of scale seems to depend on the nature of the property regime. So we can imagine a property regime that is rich in different forms of temporary or conditional property rights and helps organize the coexistence of different stakes held by different right holders in the same productive resources. And that would be the legal organization of cooperation. So there would be groups of workers and technicians and professionals who would share certain claims on productive resources rather than enjoying the absolute property right. Property, the jurists came to understand, is simply a bundle of relations and powers, which in the history of law is mainly disaggregated into different claims and vested in different tiers of right holders. And it seems that this new economy, or the innovation economy, or the knowledge economy, by the very nature of its technologies, is especially conducive to the reinvention of this 19th century ideal. And that would have tremendous significance as part of the effort to disseminate the vanguard form of production in large sectors of economic life. Now, these considerations in turn relate to a third element about the status of labor. So one element is the relation among the three forms of labor, of free labor: wage labor, self-employment, and cooperation. And the second element is the nature of the background property regime in either constraining or facilitating the emergence of self-employment and cooperation to a central role in the organization of the economy. The third element, with respect to the status of labor, is the relation of the worker to the machine. Now, this is very interesting. So, in Adam Smith's Pin Factory, or in Henry Ford's assembly line, the worker works as if he were a machine. The physical movements of the worker in the hyper-specialized technical division of labor reproduce the movements of the machine with which he is working. He mirrors the machine. Now, this seems to be a very inferior view. Inferior not just morally, but economically, productively, of the relation between the person and the machine. And against that view, we can mobilize the following conception. What is a machine? Everything that we have learned how to repeat, we can embody in a formula. And everything that we can express in a formula or in an algorithm, we can in turn embody in a physical contraption, which is the machine. The nature of the machine is to do for us everything that we have learned how to repeat. The machine is the repeatable, even the most sophisticated machines. And the purpose of the machine is therefore to do for us what we have learned how to repeat, so that all of our time can be preserved for the not yet repeatable. And then the combination of the person and the machine will be immensely more powerful than the machine or the person all by themselves. That's the higher conception of production resembling imagination. Now it seems that a progression along these lines is impossible so long as economically dependent wage labor remains the dominant form of free labor, And so long as we have a very restricted idea of the possible forms of the organization of property. So these themes are all connected. So what I'm trying to suggest is that the agenda that I'm proposing to you does not simply relate to the central terms of the contemporary economic debates about growth and about inequality. It also relates to everything that is excluded from those debates, and especially to the paramount question of the status and the future of labor. It's only when we begin to imagine institutional alternatives and to relate the debate about institutional alternatives to the understanding of the potential of the most advanced practice of production, that we can then begin to reshape our basic assumptions about how human labor can be performed. So this is a tremendous agenda. And this is an agenda worthy of Marx and of Smith, and of course completely unlike what now passes for economics. So a powerful set of ideas about production has to have these two horizons. This is the claim that I'm making. It has to look to the world that is in front of us with its debates about growth and inequality. But it also has to look to what that world is unable to see, which are these larger possibilities for the future. It has to have this visionary impulse, which is intimately related to the depth of its insight. And this was the attitude of the classical economists, the great social thinkers of the past, which we should not simply read about in libraries or see in museums, but should want for ourselves. So that's an initial account of the forefront theme of the course. Very ambitious. Yes.
Professor, when you mentioned this natural assumed form of the market, particularly now when you entered into the labor example,
yes,
it seems to me that there is also a political counterpart of dogmatic and legal institutional blueprints, which would be a liberal representative democracy on the political side.
Yes.
And assuming that separation between economic and political is just a theoretical one, up to what point will we be discussing this
Absolutely. Experimentation
on the political side when we discuss these new markets?
Absolutely. So this is another theme that comes up in the discussion of the institutional alternatives in economic life. The relation between economics and politics. And it must come up for the following reason. The reason is that the institutional assumptions of a market economy are not defined within the market economy. The institutional assumptions of a market economy are defined outside the market economy in law, in politics, and in thought. So the framework is established outside. And therefore, we have to discuss this question of how the framework is established, given that the framework isn't self-established. So I refer to Hayek's idea, which is that the market activity spontaneously generates its own framework. That if we allow coordination among free and equal economic agents to take place, this coordination will automatically generate an institutional framework. I'm going to want to argue that that view is false, and that the history of modern legal thought is a demonstration of its falsity, that there are countless ways in which a system of free coordination can be organized with dramatically different consequences, not just for distribution, but for production and exchange. So that we can't generate the institutional framework out of the practice of coordination. So then the contest over the form of the market has as its second step a contest over the form of the mechanism of political selection. So one great project in contemporary life would be democratizing the market. Adopting the economic institutions that would produce a sustained broadening of economic opportunity. And that would include what I call a progressive approach to the supply side, rather than an exclusive focus on the demand side. A second great project would be equipping the individual worker and citizen, so that he is not a puppet or a plaything, so that he is capable of resisting, of transcending, of thriving in the midst of radical innovation and conflict. And that might require, for example, a completely different form of education from the form that we now have. And the third great project would then be the deepening of democracy, so that we create democracies that do not need crisis to make change possible, and that facilitate our experiments with the established structure. And those projects are all related. Now, in this course, my primary focus will be on the economic theater. And so I'm going to address these other theaters as it were, tangentially. But they're certainly, as you say, and for the reasons you say, part of the debate. You know, something that's very difficult about all of this, but lends it tremendous interest, not just intellectual interest, but existential interest, moral interest, is that it has these two sides. So it has the technical side, and it has the visionary side. And they're almost never combined in the world. So this is the tremendous thing about political economy. It's about the material circumstance of humanity, the everyday. But it has this spiritual ambition. So it's not about making money. It's not about rationalizing the existence. It's ultimately about how our higher ambitions, our higher vocation, the higher vocation of humanity, can be expressed and embodied in our material life, so that the spirit doesn't simply float over the world, but becomes incarnate. This is the central ambition. This is the higher ambition. And it requires not only a high level of ambition, but with ambition, a high level of patience. Because it's easy to be a visionary when you float. And when you don't confront the material constraints of human life. The hard thing is this confrontation of the spirit with the material details. And that's what this is about in the context of the history of thought. So I can't say enough about how fabulous I think it is as a project. None of us could ever hope to do it adequately, but the mere fact of addressing it is already an affirmation of a certain view that we have of ourselves. That we're not just the subservient to the circumstance and the structure in which we happen to have been born and find ourselves, and that we can distance ourselves from it and pass judgment on it. That's the spirit. So I wanted to say a word about the background theme of the course, which is the intellectual project. But there's no point in rushing. So let me ask you first whether you want to question further this initial map that I presented. All right, so the background, yes.
I've been also at your class yesterday, and what I've been wondering is, what is your anthropology? What is your understanding of the human? Just if you could place it with some kind of traditions, because at one level, I can clearly see the critical tradition in there, non-alienating labor, emancipation, etc.
Yes.
But there's also a lot of resonance with what we would today describe as neoliberal rationality, innovation, self-creation, self-entrepreneurs, self-employment.
Yes.
Something which has the WTO has promoted all over the world. So there is a tension which I feel, and I would very much like you to.
I don't want to enter into a full discussion of a view of humanity, right? But I will say a word about this because I think your provocation is entirely fair and legitimate. So it is true that my arguments here, and even this initial presentation, presume a certain view of humanity. And at least in this context, in the context of the argument of this course, I don't propose to develop that view, and much less to defend it. So to the extent that it can be defended, I want it in this context to be defended by its consequences, by its fruits. So to examine it not as a philosophical conception, but in its expression in political economy. And I think that's exactly the kind of answer that Marx or Smith would give if faced with a similar question in this context. But there is a view, and the view is, it goes along the following lines, that we are shaped by context, by circumstance, by the regimes in which we're born, but we are not exhausted by them. So we are context shaped, but at the same time context transcendent. So there is more in us, in each of us individually, and in all of us collectively, the humanity, than there is or ever can be in these political, economic, and cultural orders that we build and inhabit. They are finite in relation to us, and we are infinite in relation to them. We spill over. We are capable of accessing forms of experience and insight and association that they prohibit. And then we retrospectively change the regime, the social regime or the conceptual regime, to accommodate what we have discovered. So in the theological vocabulary, this is a divine aspect of humanity. And the the highest forms, the most advanced forms of production, because they are the forms that are closest to the imagination, seem to be forms that allow us to express this vocation of ours, of transcendence, of transgression, of invention in our material life. Now, that's a view. And let me, to define the character of this view, one way to define it is by contrast to a different view of material life, which is that material life is merely instrumental. It's a very common view. So Keynes, for example, the most influential economist of the 20th century, in his essay on economic possibilities for our grandchildren, repeated the notion that we would eventually become so rich that we could diminish the part of the day required for production or work, and then we could devote our time to private sublimities. So material life is instrumental. I'm not approaching economic life in that way. I'm not approaching it as simply the prison house of scarcity from which we seek to be liberated through a world of the private sublime, of hedonism, of art, of privatized religion. I am taking the view, which I take to be the orthodoxy in the West, both philosophical and religious, that spirit and body are inseparable, and that if we are to be liberated, our liberation must touch on our full material circumstance and not simply be, as it were, an afterthought, something that happens after material life is taken care of. Material life itself must be transformed. That's the philosophical perspective from which I'm proceeding. Non-instrumental, that we transform ourselves by transforming the world, and affirm in this activity of self-transformation our vocation to transcend. And therefore, our economic progress is more than instrumental, is more than an instrumental part to the construction of humanity. It's the expression of who we are. That's the view from which I'm proceeding. But I can't hope to defend that view directly. As I say, it simply explains the conception from which I'm proceeding. So this is all part of the forefront theme of the course. But the course has a background theme. And the background theme is one about which I can now say only a very few words. So the background theme is the nature of the ideas that we need. And I will begin by a polemical statement about what now passes for economics. So there are two conceptions of economics. One is economics is the study of the economy. The other is economics is the study of economics. And actually, for the most part, it's the latter, what economics is understood as been. So if you take a course in these elite universities in economics, for the most part, you will not study the economy. You will study the method which was invented by the marginalist theoreticians at the end of the 19th century and subsequently developed, which is often applied to economic problems, but often applied to many problems that aren't economic at all. And the study of the economy by other methods is not recognized as economics. So in the university culture, there's this marriage of method and material, which is naturalized by the professoriate. And the extreme example is economics. Economics is the most extreme and exclusive and punitive version of this naturalization of the marriage of method and subject matter. So what is taken as economics is this method, which began at the end of the 19th century and was pioneered by in the generation of Walras and Menger and Jevons. And it's a very peculiar event in the history of thought. So a form of explanation, which was much less a causal science than it is, as the Austrian economist pointed out approvingly, a kind of logic. So paradigm of comparative maximizing choice in the disposition of scarce resources on a set of simplified assumptions. The assumptions are not supposed to be descriptive of reality. They're supposed to be a heuristic device that makes possible a certain form of analysis. And then the practice proceeds by relaxing the assumptions. And then in the light of this relaxation or variation of assumptions, producing different models in the language of mathematics. Now, to my mind, the tradition inaugurated by this intellectual revolution of the late 19th century has four crucial defects. And it is essential to understand these defects, these limitations, to grasp what economics has since become. So the first defect is the most fundamental. And it could be summarized in a formula, polemically the following way. There is theory and empiricism in economics, but they have very little to do with each other. This is the basic problem of the quasi-logical, non-causal science that was produced by the marginal revolution. So, in the rigorous form of post-marginalist economic theory, there can be no contentious factual stipulations, causal theories, or normative commitments. It is a pure quasi-logical method of analysis. And it works by virtue of the fuel supplied to it from outside. So the fuel are the factual stipulations, the causal conjectures and theories, or the normative assumptions and commitments. They're not generated within the theory. They have to be supplied exogenously. And then the combination of the logical analysis with the theory works. Now, supposedly economics suffers from physics envy and wants to be like physics, but this is completely unlike physics. Because there is no dialectic, there is no interplay between the theory and the empirical inquiry. So there is no accumulation of facts that could in any way jeopardize the basic theoretical assumptions of marginalist economics, because it was never meant to be descriptive. It's a logical procedure. So the empirical ideas, the causal ideas, and the normative ideas come from outside, either ad hoc or imported from some other discipline, political philosophy, psychology, sociology, and so forth. And if the model doesn't work, you form another model. You don't revolutionize your theoretical apparatus the way you would in the history of physics. So there's a joke of Groucho Marx's that goes this way. He says, I have principles, and if you don't like them, I have other ones. And that is a facetious description of this situation. In the toy model building of post-marginalist economics. So I take that to be the first defect. The second defect is the deficit of institutional imagination. In two moves. At two levels. So one is the identification of maximizing rationality in the comparative disposition of scarce resources with the abstract conception of the market. But that is much less significant than the second identification, which is the identification of the abstract conception of the market with a particular version of the market economy. Namely, the market institutions and the legal regime that evolved in modern Western history. And thus, to this day, the economist, for the most part, believes, contrary to what the jurist thinks, that a market is a market, contract is contract, and property is property. That they have, to a very large extent, a natural and predefined content. The third defect in this tradition of economic theory is that it lacks any proper account of production. So it's a theory of exchange. Post-marginalist mainstream economics is very largely a theory of exchange. And it views the world of production as a shadowy extension of the world of exchange under the lens of relative prices. And there is a very particular fact that facilitated this subordination of the problems of production to the problems of exchange. And it is the very fact to which I referred earlier in today's class in another context, which is labor being bought and sold. If labor were not bought and sold, if economically dependent wage labor were not the preponderant form of free labor, it would be much harder to assimilate the problems of production to the problems of exchange and to view them through the lens of relative prices. So a problem like the problem that I discussed earlier today, the fate of the vanguard sector of production, is not a problem that occurs naturally and easily in this agenda of post-marginalist economics. The fourth problem is that this theory of post-marginalist economics is like half of a theory in the following respect. It's a theory of competitive selection in the market that lacks a corresponding theory of the genesis of the diverse material on which the mechanism of competitive selection operates. So the fecundity of a method of competitive selection depends in large part on the richness of the material from which it selects. To explain the point that I have in mind, let me make an analogy to the neo-Darwinian synthesis in the life sciences, in biology. So in biology, there is a theory, there is a Darwinian theory of natural selection. And there is a theory of genetic mutation or recombination. And they go together. Now, where's the other part of the theory? In economics, it doesn't exist. So, for example, the division of the world into separate states is the premise of trade theory. And of the single most powerful doctrine of economics, which is the Ricardian doctrine of comparative advantage. But from the standpoint of pure economic theory, the division of humanity into separate states is just an accident or an embarrassment. It has no proper economic significance. The world could just as well be a single state. And that's because there's no view in this tradition of economic theory of the relation between competitive selection and the creation of diversity through experiment. Now, all I'm trying to do is to evoke for you the view that this, that what we take to be economics and naturalize is in fact something very peculiar and strange, and the product of a unique intellectual evolution, unlike anything else that happened in the history of modern thought. And it has generated very powerful analytic instruments, but at the same time, it's very limited. So I have to figure out my attitude towards it in this argument, that we can't disregard it. It's the most powerful discipline that exists. We have to be able to use its tools to rate it for insight, but we can't surrender to it. And this then imposes another high level of ambition. So we have a great substantive task before us, but we lack any clarity about the proper instruments with which to execute our task. And that's all I wanted to say today. I would like the greatest amount of engagement from you in this fabulous subject matter. Thank you.